point. With us now, Peter Schiff, Euro-Pacific Capital CEO and Chief Global Strategist. You're saying that Fischer is perhaps speaking too soon. Why, Peter?
Well, remember, at the very beginning, I said we were going to have more QEs than Rocky movies, and they had five Rocky movies, so we got more to come. And in fact, when the Fed first announced the taper, I said at that time that if they tapered, they would have to reverse the process, because you can't take away the QE without creating a bear market in stocks and real estate and putting the U.S. economy back into recession. So QE4 is coming. It's going to be bigger than QE3, and it's going to do more damage to the U.S. economy.
Wait a minute. You're saying that a bear market is also coming right now?
Well, not if the Fed does QE4, okay. But if the Fed doesn't, then we're going to have a bear market. Because the only reason we had a bull market was because of the QE. You can't take away the drugs and expect the market to stay high.
But, Peter, I know they do things contrary to their positions, but it is not the job of the Fed to support the stock market. It is the job of the Fed to deal with unemployment and to deal with the value of the dollar. And you're already beginning to smile because you know they have violated their mandates before, right?
Well, first of all, the Fed can't do anything about employment. So that's a phony mandate. The Fed can't create jobs by creating inflation. Maybe they think they can, but they can't. But the Fed has targeted the stock market. The whole purpose of QE3.
Hold on a second. Wait a minute, Peter. Because there was a time when, for example, Paul Volcker, when he was the head of the Fed, he didn't give a damn what happened with the stock market. He said, I'm going to have a strong dollar. Yeah. That is my mandate. And the stock market tanked as a result of what he did. So other Fed presidents, other Fed chairmen have stood up to the stock market.
Yeah, but this is Janet Yellen. She's not Paul Volcker. And when Ben Bernanke announced QE3, he said the specific goal of quantitative easing was to raise asset prices, to raise stock prices, to raise real estate prices, to create a wealth effect that he hoped would trickle down to the overall economy. Well, it didn't trickle down. It stayed in the hands of a few people who benefited from QE. But this is the only game the Fed knows, and it's going to keep playing it until we have a crisis worse than the one we had in 2008.
Well, the way you play it out, Peter, you say that unless they keep adding quantitative easing, then we will have a bear market in stocks. They're too fearful of that, even though the role of central bankers, in essence, is to calibrate interest rates to promote growth. But are you saying that we'll never get out of QE?
It doesn't promote growth. Well, we will when there's a currency crisis. But, Liz, it doesn't promote growth. It undermines legitimate economic growth. It blows bubbles. And that's what we're doing. And, yes, if the Fed stops QE, we'll have a recession. We need that recession. The last recession didn't flow naturally because the Fed cut it short with the QE and 0% interest rates. But all that did is exacerbate the problems and delay the day of reckoning. And now we're staring at a much bigger price crisis, because if the Fed actually did the right thing and normalized interest rates, shrunk its balance sheet, and stopped QE, all the things that Janet Yellen says she wants to do, if the Fed did that, we would have a much worse financial crisis than 2008.
Hold on, Peter.
Unfortunately, we need to deal with it.
Okay, Peter. Richard Fisher, who I spoke to this week, who says there's not going to be another QE. I know it might be pie in the sky from his perspective. On the other hand, he and other people in the Fed say, look, the economy is showing signs of improvement. Whether you like it or not, Peter, there are certain indices that show the markets won't, if they do another QE, they are going to have to make the case that the economy is really desperate to justify that QE. And so far, they haven't made that case.
They're going to come up with an excuse, but what they can't do now is tell the truth.
What is that excuse going to be, though, Peter? Peter, hold on. What is that excuse going to be?
It's maybe it'll be that inflation is too low. Who knows what it's going to be? Maybe it'll be Ebola. I don't know what they're going to blame it on, but I know they're going to come up with that excuse because they can't end QE. They can't raise interest rates. But the one thing they can't do is admit that. So they have to keep talking up the economy, pretending things are good. Maybe either they're incompetent or they're lying, right? Either they know how bad things are and they don't want to say it, or they're actually foolish enough to believe it. Because some people actually believe that QE worked. Okay. And you have a confirmation bias. If you think it works, you expect it to work. But if you actually look at the economic data that's been coming out for the past couple of months, the vast majority of it has been bad or below expectations. So the economy is decelerating as the air is coming out of the bubble. Okay. And the Fed is going to blow it right back in because that's all it does.
Peter, we've got to go, but thank you for coming to us from Toronto. We do appreciate it. We did get some good consumer sentiment numbers today, David.
Though. Well, and some good housing numbers we'll talk about in just a minute, but we appreciate Peter's position as always.